Hello, welcome to this new series of videos on Python programming. This time I want to focus on object-oriented programming. Object-oriented programming, OOP, is a very powerful methodology that you have to learn if you want to be proficient in the Python programming language. Object-oriented is a methodology. It's a way to structure your programs, a way to properly design components in a system that can work together. As any other methodology, object-oriented has a theoretical part and then an implementation that differs from language to language. Python, being an object-oriented programming language, has its own implementation, which can be tricky for advanced programmers, so it's definitely confusing beginners sometimes. So I believe it's worth digging into it in detail to understand what's going on behind the scenes. Well, if you are ready, let's dive into it. Let's start with the reason why object-oriented was invented. Here, in my Python notebook, I defined a structure called lift. With this structure, we keep track of the status of a lift. We know the floor the lift is at, and the status of its doors, which can be open or closed. The Python implementation of the structure is very simple. It's a list of two values. First one is an integer representing the floor, and the second one is a string. I can also create a function printLift that prints out the status of a lift. As you can see, the function works. And it's important to note that this function doesn't change the values in the lift. It just reads them from the variable and prints them on the screen. We know, however, that functions can modify data. And we can create a function that changes the status of the doors of a lift. Let's call it openLift. It accepts a lift and it changes the second element of the list from whatever it was before to open. Once again, we can call the function and everything works. Please note, however, that this time the function changes the value of its input. In this third example, I created another type of data, which I called security lift. A security lift is pretty much the same thing as a lift, but it has a third value in the list, which is another string, locked or unlocked. And the idea is that I can open a security lift only if it's unlocked. To work with a security lift, we have to define a new function, which is called openSecurityLift. And this time we have to first test the third element of the list before acting on the second element. As you can see, this says if lift of 2 is unlocked, at that point you can set lift of 1 to open. For the third time, we can run the function and check that everything works. There is a problem though, not in the code itself, but in the way we use it. Namely, we have to remember the connection between a lift and the openLift function, and the connection between a security lift and the openSecurityLift function. Python doesn't understand the connection between the data structure and the function. There is nothing that connects a lift to the openLift function and a security lift to the openSecurityLift function. And every time you as a programmer have to keep in mind something, there is a chance to introduce a bug. So the question is, can Python remember the connection between lift and openLift? In general, between a data structure and a function that works on that data structure. And this is exactly why object-oriented was invented. Programmers were looking for a way to keep track of this connection in a language. Before we start discussing how object-oriented sorts the problem of keeping track between types and functions, let's discuss the word type itself. I already used it many times, but it is important to define it. It's a word that we will use a lot in object-oriented, so it is good to be aware of its meaning. In this picture you see an animal, and I am pretty sure that everybody agrees this is a duck. Why do we say this is a duck? Well, it has the correct colors, the proper form, and if this was an animation you could see it moving like a duck. So we say that the type of this animal is duck, because it behaves like a duck. And here behavior doesn't refer only to the way it moves, but also to how it appears. Its appearance is that of a duck, so it's a duck. But now we have a surprise. As you can see, the animal we captured was not a duck, but a very sophisticated robot pretending to be a duck. So suddenly we say that the type of this thing is no more duck, but robot. At this point, however, we are using the word type in a different way, because we are no more describing the external behavior or appearance, but the internal structure. So these are the two different meanings of the word type. One is the behavioral meaning, or if you want, the external meaning, and the other one is the structural meaning, or the internal meaning. The thing we have to learn as programmers, generally speaking, is that the behavioral meaning is more important. Whenever we connect to a system through internet, for example, we are not interested in how the system has been implemented. We just want to know how the system behaves, how we can exchange data with it. When we discuss language structures, we call this external behavior type. The term duck typing that you will hear a lot in Python and in other object-oriented programming languages was created in 2000 by Alex Martelli, referring exactly to this external behavior concept. The idea is that if you can make something behave like a duck, you can call it a duck. In computer science terms, there should be no difference between two structures implemented in different ways, if they behave the same. So, this is what I wanted to tell you in terms of the general theory of object-oriented. In the next video, we will dig into the Python implementation. We will start coding in Python and see how we can keep track of this connection between types and functions, and how the word type is implemented in Python itself. Thank you for watching.